the more that parents can frame the remote learning as back to school, the better off they're going to be. The more they can essentially let their children participate in their classrooms, their virtual classrooms, the better off they're going to be, because that will set sort of that boundary of school versus play.
Children returning to school this fall will be learning in a variety of ways. One learning model is in-person classes with added safety measures. Another involves a hybrid schedule where students attend in-person classes a few days a week and have remote classes the remainder of the week. And another is strictly remote learning. A K-State Research and Extension Child Development Specialist says one thing all these learning models have in common is that they're going to pose a challenge for students and parents. On today's Sound Living, Back to School Challenges. Sound Living is a weekly public affairs program produced by Research and Extension at Kansas State University. I'm Jeff Wickman. Closing schools because of COVID-19 was supposed to be a distant memory by fall. However, that's not the case. K-State Research and Extension Child Development Specialist Bradford Wiles says it's important for parents to recognize that this school year is going to be a challenge. Bradford, as students return to preschool and elementary school, what are some of the biggest concerns that we might have that come along with the hybrid or online type of learning?
Well, there are all different manner of challenges that go along with the hybrid or remote learning environments. I think one of the biggest things that we are faced with now is that a lot of children, young children, even, you know, middle school age children are still learning exactly how the technology is going to work. And so, you know, there's a lot of trial and error and a lot of management that's going on. We have to consider the amount of screen time that they have, but at the same point, recognize that there's a difference between just plain screen time and learning remotely. And then, you know, in the hybrid model, there are multiple other elements as well where they layer on the remote learning and then also are going to school. And there are all the health and safety challenges that go along with being in an environment where protocols for reducing the likelihood of spread of infection are in place. And, you know, the bottom line is the biggest challenge is that parents or primary caregivers need to be home during the times that their children are home. And that can be an extraordinarily difficult task to both maintain their households and, if they're able to work from home, to do that, as well as be a supportive parent during the school day.
There's a lot of juggling that's going to be going on here, as you mentioned, with parents having to really be two places at the same time.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, what I really want to urge parents to recognize is that it's a challenge and that they need to be able to take care of themselves and forgive themselves for those things that they can't control or be able to stay on top of. We're asking parents to provide for their families and be essentially in-class support staff, right? We're not asking them to teach their children right now, but we are asking them to be there to support their children and to help them with the technology. And so it really, essentially, we just pile on these different roles and responsibilities. And no one person can handle all of those things. It's just not healthy. You know, there's a reason we send kids to school before the pandemic. And, you know, part of that is that it's very burdensome for adults to be really tied to their homes during the day.
You mentioned the hybrid aspect, meaning that the students will be on campus at least part of the time, and that will have some benefits for those students.
Yeah, there are all sorts of benefits to having time together with your peers, with other students. That's such a huge element of what you're learning in those early years. We think about what we learn early on, and so many times I've said that play is the work of early childhood, and that's exactly what children need. They need to be able to play. They need to be able to interact, and that's a huge, huge difference. And so I think that's really a good reason why the hybrid model has been implemented, is that it allows for the things that young children really need.
And as I understand it, this will provide a little bit of normalcy in the fact that they'll have somewhat of a better routine.
Yeah, I mean, routines are critical for everything that we do. And so routines are critical for young children. It's how they reduce anxiety. They're able to know what to expect. And that is gigantic in a young child's mind. We kind of have an idea of what to expect when we go in, or when we sit down to take a webinar, or, you know, when we're doing the things that we're doing, you know, whether it's reading a book, watching TV, reading articles online, anything like that. We kind of know what to expect, but for young children, they don't know what to expect. They don't know what learning's going to look like. They don't know what their days are going to look like. And, you know, the pandemic has upset that across the board for adults, but it's even more difficult for young children who really rely on those routines. And so the best thing I can say for parents, primary caregivers, is regardless of whether you're doing a remote learning model, a homeschooling model, or a hybrid model, the best thing you can do for your children is to establish and maintain routines. That will help them in all of the domains of learning because it gives them an idea of what to expect.
Do you know, are the daycares also adjusting to these different schedules as well, or is that going to be another problem that parents may face?
Yeah, so there are a number of different issues with the child care facilities. One of the biggest ones is that the capacity tends to be very reduced because of the ratio of adults to children and people wanting to really limit the amount of other people their children contact. And so, you know, that's an issue. And then there are, of course, the issues with hours. So, you know, kids might get out of school at 3:30, but, you know, adults might not get off work until 5. And so how do they work those in? And, you know, those are what I want to say typical before the pandemic, but during the pandemic, it makes it increasingly difficult. Everything takes a little bit longer, right? So, you know, for many of the childcare facilities, there's a temperature check before you go in. There's a screening process and, you know, one child at a time. And it's just more burdensome. Everything takes a little bit longer and everything is just a little bit more difficult, right? And scheduling is one of those.
We often concentrate more on what they're learning from books, but they're also learning a lot from just this process, aren't they? There are some lessons that they're learning that other students have not ever had to learn.
Oh, absolutely. Nobody who's living through this right now will ever forget this period of time. You know, and let's hope that things, that we have a normal that is at least somewhat related to what we had before the pandemic. And yeah, the thing that I want parents to really understand is that they're also modeling how to handle adversity during this time, right? They're also modeling what good relationships look like or what relationships look like, right? Like in my own home, things get tense, things are hard. And so how do you, and I'm sure multiple others, how do you handle that? How do you work through it? How do you talk through it with your children, with your spouse, with the other people in your household? Those are really important elements, and we're going to make mistakes. I mean, everyone does. But, you know, reminding ourselves that this is a very, very difficult time for all of us, and that, you know, our children look to us. Whether you think they are paying attention to you or not, I promise you, they are paying attention. Even if they appear distracted, they know what's going on. You, as a parent, are their model for how things go. And so, you know, recognizing that and doing your very best to model, you know, how to handle adversity is the best advice I can give any parent.
Are children going to be a little bit confused in the fact that normally when they go back to school in the fall, that kind of signals that the kind of the lazy days of summer are behind them? Are parents going to have to maybe be a little bit more cognizant of the fact that they may have a little bit more trouble making that switch this year?
That's a great question. And the real honest answer is we don't know. This is brand new for all of us. You know, in March when the schools were shut down, at least in Kansas, that was new, but it was this is what we're doing until the end of the year as opposed to we're going back to school now. And so, you know, the real honest truth is we don't know. I would suspect that that's going to be difficult for some families. What I would say is that the more that parents can frame the remote learning as back to school, the better off they're going to be. The more they can essentially let their children participate in their classrooms, their virtual classrooms, the better off they're going to be, because that will set sort of that boundary of school versus play. But yeah, there's no substitution for proximity, for being in the same place. There's no equal to being able to have your children at school safely and interacting with other students. It's just that right now, that's really not terribly realistic for a lot of students. And so you have to be able to balance the risk to them and to your family with the benefits of learning and of interaction with peers.
I know we've talked a lot in the past about the importance of interaction and socialization for the children. How can parents and caregivers, how can they fill in some of those gaps?
Yeah, that's such a good question. So one of the ways that we have been looking at this is by essentially forming what are called pods, which is, you know, a family and another or two other families join together and agree that they're going to follow all of the safety protocols. They're going to, you know, not break the trust of the others in the group and allow their children to then interact together, again, minimizing the likelihood of infection, because when the parents do have to do the things that they need to do, get groceries, get supplies, fuel, etc., they're doing it with the utmost caution. And so that's one way. Another way is, you know, through the hybrid model, there is some interaction there. There is some engagement with peers. And then there's always, you know, the virtual ability to, you can have virtual play dates where the children are video conferencing, video chatting with each other, but of course aren't in the same room. Now, that has a deficit, but, you know, you're also maximizing the likelihood that you won't be infected or transmit the SARS-CoV-2 virus. So, you know, each of those things has a different benefit and deficit, and it's really incumbent upon us to weigh those. The thing I would say the most is the quicker we can take this seriously and everyone practice good risk mitigation techniques, the sooner we won't have to do many of these things at all.
That's really the goal, isn't it, is to get back to what we really consider not the new normal, but just the normal. That would be great, wouldn't it?
Absolutely. And, let me say that we could stop this if we all wanted to and all pulled in the same direction. And when I say that, the stark reality is a virus needs a host, and if you do not provide that, the virus will not be able to go anywhere else and will die with the last person who didn't contact anybody else. That's how viruses work. And in order to make that happen, we need to wear masks all the time. We need to wash our hands all of the time for 20 seconds. We need to keep our distance from others while wearing masks, while washing our hands. You know, these things are cumulative advantages. And, I hate to say it, but we could be done with this if we all just tried together. And I really encourage your listeners to really think about how badly they want to be able to trick or treat. How badly do you want to be able to have a Thanksgiving dinner? You know, those things are really important to us as Americans. And I would really like to see Americans recognize that we're all in need of normalcy. And the way to do that is to do the things that public health officials have been telling us.
That's K-State Research and Extension Child Development Specialist Bradford Wiles. More information is available at county and district extension offices and on the extension website, www.ksre.ksu.edu. Sound Living is a weekly public affairs program produced by Research and Extension at Kansas State University. I'm Jeff Wickman, and this is the K-State Radio Network.